My name is Ryan, and this is Second Baptist Church. On behalf of our entire SBC family and our pastor, Ivan Pitt, I'd like to welcome you to our online service.
Top of the morning to everybody. We come to you this morning, first of all, saying thank you for being God all by yourself. We going to God in prayer. O God of this morning, yesterday, today, and forevermore, Lord, we come before you just saying thank you. We say thank you because you've been so good to us. You've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. And here it is, you allowed us to see another day. A day that we've never seen before and a day that we'll never see again. But because of your goodness, your grace, and your mercy, you allowed us to see this day. Oh God, we realize that there's many that have gone on. Oh God, in the midst of this pandemic, here it is. The uncertainties of today, tomorrow, and yesterday. But we still have to hold on that you are still God. You still have all control, all power in your hand. There is nothing permitted or allowed that doesn't happen if you don't know about it. Oh God, we ask and pray that you continue to give us the faith for those who've fallen by the wayside. Father, give us the strength to pick them up, to hold them and lead them. Father, we say thank you, Lord. And then, God, we come this morning to the throne of grace, Father, just asking and praying, Father, that as we come and leave our burdens right here, that we certainly would leave them here, and that we give them all to you, and that we would not have anxiety, that we would press on and keep trusting and believing that you will do what you say you do. Oh, Father, I pray for those who are on the front lines, for those who have lost loved ones, those who are grieved and bereaved. Oh, God, we just ask and pray that you comfort them and walk with them and talk with them and hold their hands, Father. Those who are in the hospital, fathers who by themselves and can't have anyone to visit them. Oh, God, please be with them and walk with them. God, those who are on the unemployment line, those who don't have a place to sleep, those that don't know how they're going to pay their rent and their mortgage. Oh, God, you are God of all gods. You're able to provide. Father, for you provided the cattle on the thousand hills. Certainly you would provide for man. Oh God, we're just asking and praying, Father, that in this COVID time, in this season, that you would keep us, Father. that we'd hold each other's hand, we'd walk with each other and talk with each other, that we'd embrace each other. Oh God, please. Now, while on others thou art calling, Father, we ask and pray that you please don't forget about us. Don't leave us. We ask and pray, Father, that we be in your favor, that you hold us and keep us, Father. Those who are Christians and non-Christian, Father, we pray for the clergymen all across the nation who's trying to use this technology to reach people in every which way. And then, God, we pray for the man who was standing John's shoe. Father, we pray for Pastor Pitts, Father. We ask and pray that he would have a word that would touch somebody. And when those who sing, that the song would be sung, that somebody would come running to Jesus and say that they need you, Father. They would fall on their face and their knees, Father. Oh, Lord, we ask for all these blessings and other blessings in your darling son Jesus' name. Amen.
Greetings, family. Thank you for being with us today. It's giving time. It's time to worship God with the giving of our tithes, our gifts, and our offering. You all have been outstanding and wonderful in your generosity, and you've helped some significant organizations in this community and throughout the world. Today, I want you to get a closer look at one organization, and over the next several weeks, we'll highlight other organizations. But today, I Can Fly International, the president and founder, Shay Givens, all the way from Nairobi, Kenya, will share with us for a few moments. Let's welcome her.
Hello, Second Baptist. My name is Shay Givens, and I'm the founder of I Can Fly International Organization. For several years, this church has been helping save the lives of children all the way around the world in Kenya, East Africa. You've been helping children affected by child marriage, mutilation, human trafficking, rape, and extreme poverty. Well, thank you so much for all that you do. You're truly making a difference. We love you so much, and God bless.
Thank you, Shay, and what an impressive ministry that you're doing over in Kenya. And I'm so honored to be a part of this incredible movement of God. I want you all to know that we have been working with her and we'll continue to work with her in the future. Let us go to God in prayer. God, we thank you for allowing us to expand our territory. You have given us an incredible opportunity to show the love of Christ to every nation, every generation, and for every situation. And God, we thank you for the connection between Second Baptist Church and the Santa Ana community and I Can Fly International. Now, God, I pray that you will continue to be generous to us as we desire to be generous to others. I pray, oh God, that you would give us abundance so that we can do abundant things. As a matter of fact, oh God, I declare that our next year will be better than this year, where we would do exceedingly, abundantly, more than we could ever hope, think, or even imagine. We say that with humility and boldness. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God and amen.
There are several ways to give during this season of online-only services. Visit sbc.family and click Give in the top right-hand corner. You can also text to give. Just text the amount to 833-918-0019 and then follow the directions when prompted. Make your giving go further by using your bank account instead of your debit or credit card to avoid additional fees for SBC. But if you want to use your card, please consider covering the 3% service charge the church will incur. Of course, you can always mail in your offering by sending a check to Second Baptist Church, 4300 Westminster Avenue, Santa Ana, California, 92703. Because of your generous support, SBC has continued to move forward, steadfast in our mission to share Christ, build believers, and care for all.
Thank you.
To invite you to this series as we look at the parables of Jesus. And we remember that a parable is an earthly story with a heavenly truth or heavenly message. It is a way that Jesus used to get a tough message to people in a palatable way. Last week, we looked at the parable in Luke chapter 15, also was repeated in Matthew 18, and we looked at the lost sheep. Today, I want to look at the second part of this three-part parable, the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. I want to look at the second part, beginning at verse 8, and it goes this way. And suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you this, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Today, for a few moments, will you meditate with me on the topic, understanding the heart of God, the lost coin? Let's pray. God, speak to us, for your servants are listening. God, move us because we want to be in line with you. God, fill us because we are hungry for your word. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our rock, our strength, our redeemer, and a very good friend unto the end. And for this is our prayer, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Let the people of God say, amen. As you all may know, I am a runner. And the more I began to run, the more I began to experience the joys of running, loss of weight and in better shape, the joys of running, having lower blood pressure and having a stronger heart, the joys of running, being out in the world and getting sun and seeing the sights, the joys of running. But the joys of running also come with some pain. Some of the pains of running is that, you know, my knees are not quite the way they used to be, and I get some aches and some pains. But one of the things that is probably the most frustrating for me as a runner, and the more I run, the more this becomes a reality, is actually calluses that grow on the side of my big toes. And not only are they inconvenient for my wife when I try to play footsies at night, but they're also inconvenient for me, because what happens is a callus is, as I'm running and the further I run, and so if I'm training for a marathon or a half marathon and I'm putting in 10, 12, 14, 20 miles preparing, my big toes rub against my shoes. They just do. And the skin on the side of my toe gets harder and thicker, and it becomes callus. And what's problematic with the callus, it causes pain on the inside beneath the callus, but there's no feeling on the outside of the callus. And the thing is, it doesn't matter when I stop training, if I stop running, the callus does not heal itself. It must be removed. And so what I've discovered is that every now and then when I'm training, and it doesn't happen often, but it just happens every now and then, I have to have the calluses removed from my toes. And the callus, I want you to remember this, the callus is a hard, thick skin that you lose your feeling. But the thing is, beneath the thick skin, there is feeling. There is softness, but you can't feel because there's a callus. You didn't get it. This is why Jesus begins to tell this story to the Pharisees and to the teachers of the law. They were upset in verse 1 and 2. They were upset because Jesus seemed to be hanging out with the wrong crowd. As we talked about last week, he is the Son of God. He's an up-and-coming rabbi. He is one who speaks as no man has ever spoke. He was one who's been able to do what no man has ever been able to do. And he claims to be the Son of the Most High God. And they thought that he was hanging out with the wrong people. As a matter of fact, they began to mutter. They began to complain. They began to growl, they began to murmur or speak under their breath as they saw this man who's supposed to be the highest of high, the holy of holy, the greatest of the great, hanging out with sinners and tax collectors. And we talked about last week why that's problematic, because tax collectors were turncoats. Tax collectors were hated to the nth degree by the Jewish aristocracy and the Jewish people. And not only did they hate them because they were turncoats and they would collect taxes on behalf of an oppressive government, but they also looked down on sinners, those who are outside the Jewish faith and those who did not keep the law. Remember, we talked about this last week. We talked about the Jews were the keepers of the law, and so they were people of the law up here, heavenly law, but the common people or the sinners were people of the land. They were sinners. They were below. There was an upper echelon attitude of those who thought that they kept the law and they were better than those sinners who were people of the land. In other words, they had runner's toe. Their hearts had become callous that they had no feeling for those who needed them the most. And Jesus begins to tell this story, this one story with three parts. The first part we talked about last week was the lost sheep. And I want you to notice there's a progression in this story. There were 100 sheep and one was lost. That's only 1%. Here, there were 10 coins and one was lost. That's 10%. And then there were two sons and one was lost. And some would argue that both were lost. That's either 50% or 100% lost. It begins to elevate and increase in the lostness and the impact and how personal it is. The first, the sheep, was someone else's sheep that someone was caring for. Not as personal, but it was your responsibility. The second one is a coin that is yours and is valuable, but it's not as valuable as a son. And you can see there's a progression of regression of the penalty and the pain of this lostness. Are you all with me on this? Thank you very much. And so here in this second aspect of this one parable with three parts, it says, or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins. Stop. The 10 silver coins would represent when she was married that her family would dress her in her garment, but also would give her this headdress of 10 coins. Watch this. And the 10 coins represented several things. Let me give you a couple of things that it represented. One, it represented that she was married and that it was a part of her endowment or her dowry that she would take with her as she moved to be with her husband's family. And it was a reminder of her value, of her worth, of her connection with her people, that she didn't come from nowhere, but she came from something and she has some worth. And it was very important because it was symbolic. And this 10 was this symbol of completion, also a symbol of wealth and independence and security. Watch this. And it was more valuable to her than it would have been to anyone else in this new land. You got to get it. You got to understand it. Because this endowment, this dowry, this garment, this garland that was weaved around her head and that she would wear and she would be in this new land, they may not have recognized the value of it, but she would always recognize the value of it because one coin was about one day's wage, a drachma or a denarii, depending on whether you speak Greek or whether you are with the Roman government or Rome, or if you were a citizen of Rome, you would understand it to be one way or the other, but it was about a day's wage. And so this was about 10 days' wage that she had, and that means she had some value. Are you all with me on that? And so it meant all this stuff, and she was responsible for caring for, looking after that which her family gave to her, which should have been important. And I want you to understand that the sheep was lost because of its own wandering and weariness. The son in the next aspect of the parable was lost because of rebellion. But this is different. This coin was lost because it was neglected. That which was supposed to take care of it, the woman, neglected it. And it had fallen and gotten lost. Listen to what I'm saying here. It says, now, if this woman had 10 silver coins that was valuable to her and loses one, they said it would demand an action because she would recognize that this thing was very valuable and it was an embarrassment to lose it on two fronts. Listen, listen, listen. On the first front, it will be embarrassing because that which is valuable to her, she lost because she wasn't paying attention, because she was careless. She didn't check the security of the coin. But the second one is, oftentimes, if a woman was unfaithful who was married, they would take a coin of those 10 away from her, and she would wear this around her head with a missing coin, which meant that she was unfaithful. So she had to run and make sure she found it because she didn't want to be labeled as one who was an adulterer in her marriage. And I want you to kind of look at this. It says, won't you, if a woman discovered that she lost one silver coin, it says, does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? Watch this. I'm going to give you this contrast. The contrast is here. It says she lost it because she was careless. But she's going to carefully search until she finds it. She was neglectful and she lost it. And now she's going to be diligent until she finds it. Y'all with me on that? Say amen to your neighbor or something. All right. Now, here we go. It says, to light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it. Now I'm going to lay something heavy on you for a couple minutes, and then we'll go back to this piece. The woman represents in this parable the church. And it represents how the church, through its own neglect, have lost some people that we should have cared for, that we were responsible to hold on to, that we were responsible to see the value in them. And it is an indictment that Jesus is trying to point to the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. He's saying to them, you looking down on these folks, and you should see the value of them. You're looking down on these folks, and you are the ones who are supposed to hold them, embrace them, and love. You're looking down on who I'm doing ministry with when you should be doing ministry with me. Your hearts have gotten callous and hard, and I need to use this parable to shave away the rough skin so that you can feel again. Church, we are guilty of being neglectful and careless with certain people and certain groups and certain communities in our society. There are some communities that have been neglected by us as Christians and as people of God that suffer from high crime and low graduation rates. We have been neglectful for people who are right in our own atmosphere, our own space, people who have been given to us because of their sexual orientation. We look down on them and we say that they're not welcome. And it's interesting. It's interesting because we have an issue with those who are gay. We have an issue with those who have felonies. We have an issue with those who are homeless. We have issues and issues to push people away. And the ministry of Jesus always pull people in. Now, I know the counter argument. The counter argument, you got to be tough on sin. You can't just be letting folks, you know, all up in here. Wait a minute. That's not the point. The point is not that you are to be light on sin and that we don't take sin seriously. The point is that we are supposed to lead with love and a lack of judgment, and that all sin can be transformed by the loving relationship with a God who sees beyond our faults and loves us where we have needs. Boy, that's good news. If you're not excited about it, I'm excited all by myself. So let me tell you what he does. There's a process that one must do, go through in order to respond when we realize that we have been neglectful, derelict of duty, of what has been given to our care. The first thing it says that we must light a light. It says, doesn't she light a light? Light a light. Listen, when we realize that there are people who are around us that we have neglected, the first thing we must do is light a lamp. Listen to me. That it says that the woman had to light a lamp. And there's two things that you need to recognize. In the house in which she occupied, there was no windows. A Palestinian home at that time didn't have any windows, so she was in the darkness, and she had to light a lamp. And here's what I want you to understand, that if a lamp was on a shelf or if a lamp was on the wall, that she had to actually go to the wall, go to the shelf, go to the place, and grab the lamp, light the lamp. Let me tell you what that means. The lamp is reflective of the word of God. In other words, that she was in darkness with her attitude and didn't realize that she was neglectful. The church has been in darkness and had been separated from the word of God. He said that we need to take the word of God and we need to bring it close to our hearts. so that we can illumine in our own selves to see what we cannot see in the darkness of our judgment. Light a lamp, open the word of God, and begin to let it speak to you. One of the biggest challenges that I have in Bible study, one of the biggest challenges that we have in church is that people hear the word of God and they think it's for somebody else. And the word of God, the lamp of God, is to be close to you because it changes you first before it changes anyone else. Come on, somebody. We light a lamp. We bring the word close. We open it up and we allow it to illumine our own hearts. That leads to the second step. We light a lamp and then we sweep the house. Now, the house in those days were made of dirt. It was just dirt. And they would put straw over the dirt so that they wouldn't be walking on dirt. But if you had a coin and it fell to the ground, that means it had fallen through all the hay and all the straw, and it's on the, so in other words, you can't stand up here and search for a coin. You have to humble yourself and get down. Watch this. And as you're on your knees with this lamp, with this word in your heart, in your hand, in your mind, you have to shovel through the straw, sweep the straw out the way to expose the dirt where the coin might be. In other words, you have to get dirty. You have to be humble enough to get dirty to search for something that has been lost. And one of the things that I love about this illustration, because it reminds me that as I'm on my knees and as I'm moving straw and as I'm searching for that which is lost because I've neglected, it reminds me of all the dirt that God has covered over my life. That God has covered my dirty sins with his beautiful straw. And as I'm moving to look for that which is lost, I'm humbled that I would ever think that someone else doesn't get the same chance that I've gotten, a second chance. And it says, not only does she search, remove the straw, but she searches until she finds it. Can you imagine when she finds it? What may have gone through her mind? How long has it been lost? How many times have I walked over it and stepped over something that I was supposed to care for? How many days did I ignore something that should have had some attention? Jesus is trying to get our hearts to be soft. Understanding the heart of God, the lost coin, it represents the fact that we are to engage and have the word lit in us. We are to sweep and move away the straw that keeps us from seeing the realities of life. And when we search until we find it. And what's so beautiful about this coin, when you find the coin that is lost, it's been stepped on, but yet it's still worth a day's wage. It may be dirty, but it is still worth what it's worth. The value of the coin has not gone down because it's been stepped on, because it's been forgot about, because it's been neglected. And you know that it's the right coin because when you look at this coin and you dust off the dirt, you will see the image of the king of your land. And you will see that the image of the king has been pressed into the coin. And it guarantees its value because the image of the king is on the coin. You didn't get it. You may be a sinner. You may be a tax collector. You may be a liar, a cheater, a fornicator, a thief. You may be gay, straight, crooked, south. I don't know what your issue is, but you still have value. We've all been made in the image of God, and our value has been established not by our activity or by our sin, but by our Creator who made us in his image. And the interesting thing you have to get from this text is God ain't really talking about the coin. And he ain't really talking about the sinner. And he ain't really talking about the tax collector. He's really talking to those whose hearts have been calloused and they need to shave away because they've lost their ability to feel for those who they think are not valuable. Here's a test to see if your heart is hard. Why do you get angry when certain people get certain access that you don't think they should have? If you think that you deserve something that others don't deserve, why does issues around Black Lives Matter or racial equality, why does that get you so angry? How do you respond to someone who lives an alternative lifestyle when they come to your church and want to sit next to you or move next door to you? Why are you so angry? Why are you so mad? Why are you so upset? Is your heart hardened where God can't use you to search your own heart, to look at the straw that he's removed for you, to see the dirt that you used to lay in and that God came and picked you up and wiped you down and said, "You are my child"? And then it says here as we close, in verse number 9, "And when she finds it," it didn't say if, it says when. Who have we neglected? What relationships do you have to restore? And what are you going to carefully find? "And when she finds it, calls her friends and her neighbors all together and says, 'Rejoice with me. I have found that which I have lost.'" Confess and admit that I have lost my coin and I have found it because it is valuable. And it is valuable to me because it was given to me by my father and it has the imprint of the king on the coin. And it says, "In the same way, I tell you, there will be rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." God will rejoice every time one person has a heart transformation. Their mind recognizes that they're off track. Their heart aligns with the mind of this confession, and their actions change. And what he's saying to the church in this parable is that a hard heart of judgment and looking down on people and thinking that some folks are not worthy to be in the presence of the Most High God, the issue is that our hearts are hard and that we're running folks away who need to be healed. And it's so amazing that in this message today, I'm convicted because I don't want to be the one who is guilty of running folks away. Church hurt is very, very painful, but God's love is very, very wonderful. And so here's what I want us to do, and here's what I'm going to say to you as I take my seat. I don't want to be careless. I want to be careful to love someone that has been lost. I want to be a conduit of bringing people together versus pushing people away. I want to be the hands and feet of Jesus that's close to the word, that's humble on my knees, that will search through my own biases and my own calluses that keep me from seeing. I want light to be able to see the darkness that I've avoided. And I want to be one who puts my hand in the dirt to lift someone up. so that I can see their value and they can see their value as well. Our job is not the sin police. Our job is the value police. We are to go and find folks and remind them that they are guilty of being valuable in the sight of God. And I invite you to join me in helping people raise their hands. Stop. You're under arrest. God says you are guilty of being valuable in his eyes. And I pray that we all raise our hands and we rejoice as each one comes back to God. God is calling us back. He's calling us back to a good and genuine and pure relationship with him. God is calling us back to let the word light us up. God is calling us back to be on our knees and to remove the storm. And God is calling us to reach in the muck and mire and lift someone up. Will you respond today? Will you join me in being careful and not careless? Understanding the heart of God, the lost coins in our life have to be recovered. Let us pray. God, we are grateful for your word, and we thank you that you have given us another chance to engage in your word and to be moved by your word, another chance to humbly search through the muck and the mire, to reach down and to lift someone up. Thank you, God, for reminding me that I am valuable in your sight. It doesn't matter what anyone else says. I know that I am yours, and because of that, I am worth something. Thank you, O God. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Wow, what a powerful message we just heard. I don't know about you, but I'm always thankful when I come before my master. You know, I give him praise all the time, even for the little things. And when I enter into these portals, I praise his name. I bless him for what he has done for me. And I tell you, if you would like to know this God that we serve, you can reach out to us here at Second Baptist Church. Because there may be someone out there who does not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and you want to know. Or there may be someone out there who just would like to get reacquainted, who just would like to get back and to understand and get to know and feel what church is all about once again. And I say you can do that as well. You know, we are glad to have you to come and be a part of this Second Baptist Church family. I urge you not to wait to do that, because the Lord is waiting with open arms, and so are we here at Second Baptist. God bless you. Have a great day.
Even during this unique season, SBC has welcomed several new members, and we would be thrilled to have you become a member as well and unite with us as we share Christ, build believers, and care for all. There are two ways to become a member at SBC. You can visit our website at sbc.family and select Connect in the top right-hand corner. Enter your information and indicate "I want to join" in the message box. If you prefer to receive a call, you can add your phone number, or you can call the church office and leave your information on our voicemail. Once you've completed these steps, congratulations! Our virtual ministry team will welcome you into the SBC family.
And now let's prepare our hearts and our minds and our spirits for the benediction, a final word of blessing. And I say that often because I want you to know that a benediction is a blessing. It is a final blessing that keeps us together, that holds us until we meet again. And it is my honor to present to you God's benediction. Let us pray. And now may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. The peace that surpasses all understanding, and may that peace rest, may it rule, may it abide now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Let all God's children say, amen.
Greetings, SBC, and welcome guests. These are your Sunday service announcements.
Looking to stay healthy and support SBC in the process? Please consider purchasing an embossed SBC face mask. These stylish 4-ply face masks provide superior comfort and protection, contain pockets for removable filters, and are 100% cotton. The cost is $20, and all of the proceeds go to SBC's COVID-19 Relief Fund, which supports SBC members who have been hit especially hard during this challenging season. To stay healthy and support this effort, buy your face mask today by visiting sbc.family/give.
For contact information for any of these events, please go to our website at sbc.family or call the church office. Thank you, SBC, and have a blessed day.